All right, we're going to get started. It is such an honor for me to have the opportunity to introduce our keynote speaker, Norman Ornstein. Mr. Ornstein's keynote address is always one of the major highlights of this conference, at least for me, and I know for many of you. You may be surprised to hear that this is his 20th time addressing this as the keynote speaker. So, of course, I have a bio for him, and I'll share some of his key accomplishments, but like any other American seeking truth, I turn to the greatest source of truth, Wikipedia. And I validated this with him before. It said that he was a child prodigy, that he graduated high school at the age of 14, and graduated college at the age of 18. So clearly we're dealing with a brilliant man here. Norman Ornstein is a longtime observer of Congress and politics. He is a contributing editor and columnist for National Journal and The Atlantic, and is an election eve analyst for BBC News. He also serves as co-director of the AEI Brookings Election Reform Project and participates in AEI's Election Watch series. He led a working group of scholars and practitioners that helped shape the law known as McCain-Feingold that reformed the campaign financing system. He was elected as a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences in 2004. He is also a very well-known author. His books include The Permanent Campaign and Its Future, The Broken Branch, How Congress is Failing America and How to Get It Back on Track, and most recently, the New York Times bestseller, It's Even Worse Than It Looks, How the American Constitutional System Collided with the New Politics of Extremism. That book was named one of 2012's best books on politics by The New Yorker and one of the best books of the year by The Washington Post. We are indeed fortunate to have Dr. Ornstein with us today, and it is my great privilege to invite him to the podium at this time.
Thank you, Teresa. It's a great delight to be back for the 20th year. I should note that that last book had a new edition last year called It's Even Worse Than It Was. And the next one, Run for Your Lives. I want to apologize in advance because I've got some jokes that are new. You're the first audience to hear them, so it's a little bit like the tryout. We'll see what works and what doesn't. But I do want to start with a moment of silence for the victims of the Bowling Green Massacre and the Swedish Massacre. As I was saying to Frederick Douglass last night, it's just a couple of great tragedies. Actually, IKEA is now selling a memorial for the victims of the Swedish massacre. And I went to get it, but I couldn't put it together. The instructions were just way too complicated. Just a couple of things from this morning's conversation. Dean Rosen talked about the Pottery Barn rule, which actually had originally come from Colin Powell. You break it and you own it. It's never been there, actually, but there is a new Pottery Barn rule. You break it, you're deported. So you don't even have to break it, you're deported. Also, this morning we had a very interesting juxtaposition. Jim DeMint, this is not a joke, except in other ways. Jim DeMint was at the CPAC conference and basically said, you're to repeal it now. There is no replace nonsense. You promised to repeal, and that's it, and got a thunderous ovation. Then, of course, we had John Boehner in Florida saying, repeal, replace, what crap, we're not going to do any of that, you know, forget about it. And it's going to be interesting to see how those two pull themselves together. The other news this morning was actually a few news reports saying that the repeal plan has been pulled because the numbers from CBO were, to use the word, horrific. So we've got some interesting times ahead. Last year when I was here, we did talk a lot about Donald Trump. He had already thrown his hair into the ring of presidential politics. Little did we know that the new national anthem would be We Shall Overcome. Much less that we'd have a new reality show called Dancing with the Czars. It's been a rough beginning, though, in the presidency for Donald Trump. This is supposed to be the honeymoon. You'd think by his fourth one, he would know a little bit better. But those of you who were here last year will remember that I tried to reassure you by saying if he ever did become president, within a few months he'd leave us for a younger country. So we will see. Didn't know that younger country would be Russia, but. And of course, we had CBS anchor Scott Pelley last week saying that Trump was, and I quote, divorced from reality. That's his third divorce as well. But he's regrouping now by doing more rallies, and he did a big one you probably saw in Palm Beach. Melania started by reading the Lord's Prayer, and then she said, that was just a little something I composed, especially for this occasion. Actually, as we can see, Trump has a very complicated relationship with his wife. When his staff told him last week that there was going to be a day without immigrants, he said, well, that's what I say when Melania's in New York. The president is now that he is president, trying to get in shape. He said he's going to give up on the fast foods, no more McDonald's or Kentucky Fried Chicken, and he's going to try to get Chipotle deported. Hey, that one doesn't work quite so well. But enough about Trump. We're actually, of course, also seeing an administration take form, some of the cabinet in place, some not. We did have Andy Pudzer, the nominee for Labor Secretary, forced to withdraw. But it's not a scandal. He just said he wanted to spend more time with Michael Flynn. We have Chris Christie now saying to his friends that he is going to take a job in the White House. My speculation is food taster. And I will say, last week I was up in New Haven. We had this massive snowstorm in the Northeast. All the public schools were closed from New England all the way down to New York. So Betsy DeVos's plan is ahead of schedule. So, as always, I like to get you laughing because it's all downhill from here. My role is to get you to laugh and cry at the same time, as I've been doing an awful lot. I want to try and step back and look a little bit more broadly at the dynamics, then talk a little bit about what we might see or expect from a Trump presidency, not just a month in, but trying to project ahead a little bit, and following on what this, as is every year, terrific panel talking about the prospects for health reform, speculate a little bit on that as well. Now, I'm going to use three phrases here that I think are the particularly relevant ones. Angry populism, partisan tribalism, and uncharted territory. Let me talk for a bit about the angry populism. Populism as a phenomenon is deeply ingrained in America's cultural and political DNA. It goes back right to the beginning of the Republic, the idea that people in positions of power are to be viewed with some suspicion, that they have feet of clay, that power corrupts, and all of that. Our whole constitutional design built around trying to make sure that you wouldn't have a demagogic process that could take over and corrupt power, along with a fear of where rampant populism could take you, building in checks and balances against it. But we've seen it erupt at different times in a big way throughout the course of American history. The most prominent and significant before now, of course, was in the 1820s with the election of Andrew Jackson in 1828. There are a couple of wonderful biographies that will tell you a little something about the historical roots, but also the way in which governance took place. Jackson was elected in 1828 after an enormous public backlash because the 1824 election had not resulted in an outcome that was definitive. There were four main candidates who split the electoral votes, and popular votes didn't mean a whole lot back then. The top three go to the House of Representatives. The fourth one, who didn't make it, was the Speaker of the House, Henry Clay. Andrew Jackson had won a plurality of those electoral votes and of the popular votes. Clay didn't like him and maneuvered to make John Quincy Adams the president. Shortly thereafter, Clay became the Secretary of State, and Jackson ran for 4 years against the corrupt bargain that Washington had produced and came in a landslide and governed as a populist. He blew up the National Bank. He basically went on a almost jihad against the Indians, was a racist, had a lot of other characteristics, but was strong and tough and powerful and is one of Donald Trump's role models that he talks about a lot. Likes the strong, tough people and liked the populist message. Now, in the aftermath of that, we saw plenty of other times when populism emerged. It came in big in the 1890s. This time with another Democrat, William Jennings Bryan, who ran against the elites, was the Democratic nominee three times in a row, but never got elected president. We saw populism in the 1930s, and you could make a case that if Huey Long had not been assassinated, he was posing a significant problem in the Democratic primary process to Franklin Roosevelt. And if you ever saw the movie All the King's Men or read the books about Huey Long, you will see that it was very much the kind of populism that we've seen emerge now, and of course at a time of enormous turmoil economically in the country, a sense of the people being left behind, the forgotten man. It had some resonance, but it never really took off. We also saw a version of populism on the right with Father Coughlin, a nativist element and protectionist elements there. We saw it emerge again in the late 1980s and early 1990s. I'm giving you a very brief history lesson. What really triggered it then was a pay raise for public officials that had been engineered by all the elites in 1988. We had a commission, they called them quadrennial commissions, the captains of industry, of labor, of the academic community, all around, who decided that because there had not been a pay raise for judges and members of Congress and top executives for a decade, they were falling behind, we were having difficulty getting judges, members of Congress had to keep two households, it was getting tough, and they'd make up for inflation for the decade and give them a 25% pay raise. Ronald Reagan signed off on it, turned it over to his successor, George Herbert Walker Bush, who agreed to it. The congressional leaders of both parties went along and the public went berserk. The common reaction was, if I'm lucky, I get a 1% COLA. I'm stuck here in a stagnant economy going nowhere. And these people making $87,500 a year when I'm making maybe 25, say they don't have enough and they're getting a 25% increase. Now, the year before, 1987, the Federal Communications Commission had eliminated the fairness doctrine. And all of a sudden, there were new opportunities for communication. Rush Limbaugh had been a radio talk show host in San Diego, moved to New York to try and become a national figure, and the pay raise was like the giant booster rocket moving him to prominence. After this pay raise came out, I supported it, and I went on the then CNN show Crossfire. It'll tell you something about our communications now and cable television and CNN that I sometimes yearn for Crossfire to be back. But I sat there with Ralph Nader on one side of me and Pat Buchanan on the other, and they both said exactly the same things, and I felt like the Oreo in the cream in the cookie between the two sides being squeezed. I went home, took two showers, it wasn't enough. But of course, as we moved to 1992, Bill Clinton, the Democratic nominee, George Herbert Walker Bush, the incumbent president, and we had Nader on the left, the populist left, and Buchanan on the populist isolationist right, and Ross Perot occupying the angry center. The populism almost always brings with it a substantial amount of nativism and of protectionism and some isolationism. Buchanan represented the isolationism. And that one neat phrase, the giant sucking sound of jobs going to Mexico, we saw the rest of it with Perot. And in June of 1992, Ross Perot, or in May, led in the polls over Clinton and Bush. Now, he then, over the next couple of months, demonstrated that his tray table was not in its full upright and locked position and got 19% of the popular votes. So this is a deeply ingrained thing. And we've had a spasm now much more severe than anything we've seen in our lifetimes in the aftermath of the financial collapse and then the bailout, the TARP program, Troubled Assets Relief Program, in the fall of 2008, supported by all the elites, President George W. Bush, Treasury Secretary Hank Paulson, Fed Chair Ben Bernanke, all the previous chairs of the Fed, everybody in the financial and business world, the two presidential candidates, Barack Obama, John McCain, the congressional leaders of both parties. The populism was there before this because they all said, not only will our economy collapse, the global economy will collapse, we'll have a credit crunch, it'll lead us into something that'll make the Great Depression look mild by comparison. We gotta do it now. And they brought it up in Congress, and it failed in the House of Representatives because the House Republicans said, why should we listen to you? The Dow dropped 700 and some points, it came back, it got passed. You can make a case, which I would, that it saved us from catastrophe. It actually did not end up costing. But the reaction of a very substantial share of the public was, so what you did was you bailed out the miscreants who got us into this mess and then let them take big bonuses. And they all walked away. We lost our houses. And if we didn't lose our houses, they dropped in value by 30 or 40 or 50%. And for most Americans, the only asset they have for their retirement, for their kids, was their homes. We lost our jobs, and if we didn't lose our jobs, we got stuck in jobs where the employers knew we had nowhere to go. And so they screwed us. You're going to work longer hours, you're going to get less pay. And the reaction was fierce, and it brought us the Occupy Wall Street movement on the populist left and the Tea Party movement on the populist right. And they're still enduring and strong, and in some respects they've gotten tougher and bigger and more prominent. Now, the Occupy Wall Street movement didn't seem like a whole lot at the start. And it's a reflection, I think, of the culture of the left to some degree. They occupied. They went out and got tent cities across from Wall Street and in Washington. And they were going to show everybody. And then after a couple of months, it got really smelly. And they folded up the tents and left. But you could see from Bernie Sanders and his strength out there in the campaign that the attitudes didn't go away. The right behaved in a different fashion. They organized from the ground up. They got candidates. They organized to run politically and to act politically, and obviously became a major and potent force. And it was a force that the leaders of the Republican Party saw when Barack Obama became president and exploited by going out and fomenting the anger, exploiting the anger, recruiting candidates, and bringing them in with the promise that they would bring Barack Obama to his knees if they had the reins of power, and they would force him to repeal Obamacare and to repeal Dodd-Frank and to blow up government as we know it, and they were going to use the debt ceiling as an issue in the 2010 campaign and then as the leverage, and of course it didn't happen. They didn't eliminate a single program. They did not get much of anything done that they said they would do, and then they went out and said, you know what? Doesn't matter really, because we have unmasked this Kenyan socialist president, and of course the American people will reject him, and in 2012 we'll win the presidency, and then we can get rid of all of these things. And of course he won big time, and then it was, well, yeah, but they outnumber us 2-1. It's like you're in a wrestling tag team, and they've got two and we've only got the one. They've got the House and the Senate, or the presidency and the Senate. And if we win the Senate, we'll outnumber him 2-1, and then we can force him to his knees, yada, yada, yada. And they won the Senate, and none of it happened. And so you move to the 2016 elections, and you not only have the Sanders phenomenon on the left, but as I suggested to you last year, that you had 17 Republican candidates in an open contest, and the majority of them were outsider candidates, running against their own party's establishment almost as much as they were against the left and the Democratic Party. And it was very clear that the establishment figures, those who had always won nominations in the past, because they'd flirt with the Herman Cains of the world, but then they'd come back and pick somebody who had been an heir apparent, who'd run before, who occupied a major office, and it wasn't going to happen this time. Jeb Bush, who was the obvious choice, had all the money, and you know, you'd had Bush 41 and you'd had Bush 43, and the model mantra in the family was no child left behind. one child now left behind. But that the Republican nomination, which could have gone to a Carly Fiorina, a woman who'd been a business executive, or could have gone to a Ben Carson, a great family life story, and an African-American and a renowned neurosurgeon. But it came down to, fundamentally, Ted Cruz and Donald Trump. Ted Cruz, the insider's outsider. Yeah, he's in the Senate, but his calling card was going on the floor of the Senate and calling his own leader, Mitch McConnell, a liar, for which he was not muzzled, interestingly enough. And you had Donald Trump, who came into this as kind of a curiosity, one of the 17. How did he emerge? Because what Trump saw was that if he got to the right of every other candidate on immigration issues, and that was not easy to do with Ted Cruz, but he did. That's when he began to talk about the Mexican rapists and building the wall and making Mexico pay for it and the Muslim ban and all of that, that he suddenly vaulted into prominence. But it was also that he took on the other candidates and belittled them, that he took on even Fox News. And it was saying, in effect, all these other Republicans, they're weaklings. They didn't do what they said they would do. I'm the tough guy. I'm not backing down to anybody. And all of that resonated as well. So I want to just step back a minute, though, and reflect on the notion that the angry populism that we have is not just because he took a set of positions that responded to nativism and racism and some of those phenomena out there that have been growing as the country has become more diverse and as it is moving inexorably by 2040 or so to one where a majority of Americans will be minorities. But it also reflects both larger sets of problems in the society and global phenomena, and some of them are rooted in a larger history as well, and we're starting to see a lot of books emerge on that front. A good part of it is that sense of economic dislocation, and the element that was emphasized far more by Democrats early on and liberals in the campaign, but which has become obviously more and more apparent to others, which is the yawning and growing inequality in the country as one group of people have emerged doing extraordinarily well. And one of the great puzzling phenomena to me in some ways is that the 0.1% who have made far more money through the Obama years than they ever did in the rest of their lives see themselves as victims here. And I often reflect on the moment when Steve Schwarzman, a multi-billionaire head of the Blackstone Group, when Obama said, you know, maybe we should revisit the tax rate for carried interest, likened it to Hitler invading Poland. I kid you not, those were his terms. But if you're there struggling to make a go of it and your wages are stagnant and you've been promised that in this new world, this new era where technology is emerging and everything can be available to people and it's not working for you, you're not going to be real happy with what's going on. And that's not just true of working class people. It's also true of some people who do exactly what the society has said they should be doing. They're working hard, and they're putting food on the table, and they've got a home for their families and their children. But they look out there, and as they see it, others who aren't doing as well are making out like bandits compared to them. And one part of this is, and it's, I think, a dilemma whenever we begin to talk about health policy and we talk about the need to provide subsidies. What if you're just a few thousand dollars above that subsidy level and you got two of you working and you're looking at people who are just below that subsidy level and they're getting their insurance for much less than you're paying? You're not going to feel very happy about that. And it's always, you know, you have to have a cutoff at some point, but how you manage the cutoff, one of the real difficulties, I think, that added to the anger out there that made for a riper environment was not just working class white people unhappy about what's going on, but middle class people. And those middle class people, strangely enough, in this very, very strong piece written by a law professor at Hastings in the Harvard Business Review about her husband's family, for them, middle class people working hard, they're angry and upset and suspicious of the professional class. But the ultra rich, they don't, for some reason, view in the same way. They see them as people who earn what they got. And so a Donald Trump can come along and have that kind of appeal. Now, let me turn for a few minutes to talk about the partisan tribalism. And really, the larger theme of the book, it's even worse than it looks, which, by the way, still makes a great holiday gift. any holiday. It doesn't matter what the holiday is. Festivus. Pick your holiday. And it is very good for the airing of grievances. Is that we focus a lot on polarization, which is obvious. And we know that for a whole set of reasons, we have moved further apart in basic viewpoint and ideology, and the center and the political arena has come close to disappearing. But you can have polarization and still solve problems. Orrin Hatch, Ted Kennedy worked together to create the CHIP program, which may or may not continue as is. And Henry Waxman, who was not a centrist, had his fingerprints all over every piece of social policy and health and the environment for 40 years, with his biggest accomplishments coming by interacting with and cutting deals with Ronald Reagan and the Republicans in Congress. But we've turned to tribalism. Tribalism is where if you're for it, I'm against it, even if I was for it yesterday. And you see a lot of that on the healthcare front. We know where the framework came from. And it also means that you do not sleep with the enemy. You do not cooperate. You do not work with them. And what's happened is something that I would argue really began to take hold with Newt Gingrich in his emergence in the House in the late 1970s, and the attempt to create a deeper division between the parties and to break the Democrats' stranglehold on Congress by nationalizing the election and making people believe that anything would be better than what we've got. That created a generation of people with a deep hatred towards Washington and politicians, but also was designed to radicalize Republicans against Democrats who were in charge, and especially those in Congress who had worked with Democrats in the minority because that's what they were there for. And then began to build, and the pay raise, the populism, the emergence of talk radio, the new media, the tribal media, all of that moved us in a different more difficult direction. And it was something exploited for ruthless, pragmatic reasons by the young guns in the House, Eric Cantor, Kevin McCarthy, Paul Ryan, and especially by Mitch McConnell in the Senate. Not just my number one goal is to make Barack Obama a one-term president, but as he said after the successful midterms, well, of course we weren't going to work with him or the Democrats, because if we had, they would have legitimized the policies, people would have liked them, and they would have gotten credit for it. But all of that was an attempt to delegitimize the policies and the president and exploit them, and that added to the tribalism. And it is metastasized dramatically to the states and to the public at large. And what we know about our elections now is they are driven by negative partisanship, much more than they are by people's attachment to their own political party. It is much more about they're evil and we have to beat them, with a substantial dose of unease and suspicion of one's own party leaders. And just to take it through the election, that's how a Bernie Sanders, who had never been a Democrat for a day in his life until he ran for president, who had a core of supporters, most of whom were younger than his suits, and who left the Democratic Party the day after he dropped out of the presidential race, could have the kind of cohesion that he got and could still be a prominent factor, no longer a Democrat, in choosing the head of the Democratic National Committee. But it's also why Donald Trump, who had had as many parties as wives, who had been a Democrat, had been an independent before he became a Republican, was clearly not enamored of the Republican Party itself, could have a whole lot of people going around and supporting him. Now, take it to another level, and as we talk about a president who has plummeted since he got elected, who's at a 38% on average approval rating in most of the surveys, and I have people saying to me all the time, well, you know, are they going to impeach him? What are they going to do? How come the Republicans, because every time we've seen a president go underwater in approval, his own partisans start to get distance from him. Why are they not getting distance from him? Go back to when we began to use public opinion to measure presidents in any kind of serious way. Dwight Eisenhower, okay? If you looked at Eisenhower's approval ratings and divided them by party, there was a difference about like this, Democrats and Republicans. And as he rose and fell, and it was in a fairly narrow band, it would go just like that. Look at it now. Pew survey, 38% approval for the president. Democrats, 8% approval, 90% disapproval. Republicans, 84% approval. Strong Republicans, over 90% approval. In every one of those Republican congressional districts, those are their primary voters. And so they're not going to abandon him until those numbers change. But what we have is an increased and heightened level of tribalism. And that tribalism helps explain to some degree how Donald Trump can win. But put those two factors together and consider that in the exit polls, what we know is that 61% of voters this time said that Donald Trump was not qualified to be president, which means that perhaps a third of his voters believed, as they voted for him, that they were voting for somebody who was not qualified to be president. And that'll tell you something about the anger at politics in Washington, that sense that they're all illegitimate, that belief that anybody could do this job better, that when Donald Trump, talking to the African-American community, said, what the hell have you got to lose? And boy, are they going to see what they've got to lose, but why that resonated with a larger group of people. And now we're into a great experiment, and that's where the uncharted territory comes in. So one of the things that resonated with people, and this is deeper in the culture as well, is get a businessman in there, because they know how to do things. And so now we're going to see if government can run like a business. And so far, it is being run like Trump University. But what's striking is that if you come in, and this is the first president in American history with no connection or experience in government in any level, in any way. We've had others who've been in the military. And if you're at the top levels of the military, you interact with the political arena in a way that is every bit as much as people who are leaders in Congress. We've had others who were governors and others who've been in office in Congress. First time we've had somebody without any of that. You would expect somebody like that coming in would surround himself with people who know how the levers of power work in government to make it work. And he's done the opposite. Reince Priebus has a term in the Wisconsin state legislature and, of course, his experience as chairman of the Republican National Committee. He went to CPAC today And I was open-mouthed as he said, well, you know, we just don't like politics. And it reminded me that if you take the name Reince Priebus and remove the vowels, what you are left with is RNCPRBS. Now, I'm hoping every time you see Reince Priebus, that comes to your mind. And Steve Bannon, with no experience in government and a dark figure in so many ways, but also chose a cabinet where a very substantial number of the cabinet officers have no experience in government either. They have come from the world of business. And a president who didn't understand coming in that you've got over 1,000 positions that you have to fill below the cabinet level that require Senate confirmation. About 700 of them are fairly serious positions, and he has so far nominated 35 or so. And that means that people without experience are not going to have anybody below them with experience for a very, very long period of time. So we're going to see not just if you can run the White House like a business, but whether you can run cabinet departments without any experience, and relying on career people who are deeply distrusted by them from the get-go, a belief that they are all out to undermine what it is that you're trying to do. Now, what we also don't know is who's going to actually run things from the White House, and not just from the White House, as we saw with some of the slides earlier, and as Dean pointed out too, who's going to run things inside Washington, inside the federal government? Every president comes in as an alpha male. And it is, well, the framers obviously just had a little bit of an editing error. Article 1 is actually the executive branch. It's not the Congress. They all want to bend Congress to their will. And they find, even if they have a brief period where they can get some things done, it doesn't quite work that way. Here you have the alpha male to end all alpha males. And all alpha males have deep-seated insecurities. And here we have a narcissistic sociopath who has an enormous ego problem with a Congress that believes it's going to let him sign the bills that they send him because he doesn't much care or know about things, but also that's going to have enormous difficulty, not just in health policy, getting anything done. Because the House and Senate are not in sync, and they never are. When Newt Gingrich, another alpha male, achieved his goal, he took his party, which had not been in the majority since 1954, wandering in the desert of the minority for 40 years, and brought them to the promised land. And he was the speaker and was going to be basically the parallel president to Bill Clinton. And put his party on a baton march and passed all kinds of things, and the Senate under Republican Bob Dole went nowhere with them. They didn't have the same rhythm, they didn't have the same interests, they had a different electoral perspective, and within a couple of months, Newt was saying, I can do better with Bill Clinton in negotiations than I can with the man he called the tax collector for the welfare state. And while it's a little bit different now, it's not a lot different. And the Senate and House are not going to agree, and we're going to see enormous issues there. What role will the cabinet play? How will the president see his own role? My guess is he sees himself as the non-executive chairman of the board, and that for many areas of domestic policy, Mike Pence is the chief operating officer of that division. And it's pretty clear that many of these cabinet choices, Tom Price among them, were Pence's choices. Price, Mulvaney, these were his buddies in the House, from the most radical caucus in the House at the time, where Mike Pence was when he was in the House. How much running room are they going to have to make policy? And how much will their desires to act be contradicted, countermanded, or undermined by things that the president tweets or says? As we're seeing all the time now. And so we have a president who said shortly after the election, we got our alternative to Obamacare. It's right around the corner. Everybody's going to keep their insurance, and it's going to be better and cheaper. And then it was, no, we're not going to have a plan. And then just a little while ago, it was, well, it's going to be in early March. We got the plan. And then Tom Price said, no, we don't have a plan. Now, maybe you can govern through incoherence like that, but it's going to be very difficult to do. And at the same time, when you have a president who makes his pronouncements and promises via tweet, and we now know that there's an enormous effort in the White House, they can't take the phone away from him, but they're trying to change his mood by giving him fake news about good things happening so that he won't focus on the bad things and then put out inflammatory tweets. This is like, you can't make this shit up. I mean, it really... So the fact is we have a unique presidency here and a very different policy process. And I'll just say one other thing, which I mean seriously. I've been in Washington now for almost 50 years. And I've been around and involved enough that I've gotten to know some presidents fairly well. And I've watched the others very closely. And the one phenomenon that you see is, no matter how experienced a person is, the day after the election, they're changed. George Herbert Walker Bush, who could have more experience? He'd been in Congress. He had been an ambassador. He had been the head of the CIA. He'd been vice president for 8 years. It was, oh my God, now I'm the one making the decisions. I'm the one in charge. I'm not just in there with the president saying, hey, I think you ought to do this, but the responsibility goes with him. Now it's me. And I am responsible for the fate and well-being of 300 million Americans, but also for billions of people around the world where I've got this enormous power. This is the first president who has not changed one iota by winning the White House. He wants to change the presidency to fit his personality. And how this will work, we just do not know. And who the people around him will be who are going to be making those decisions, and what will happen when mistakes occur, as inevitably they do. And inevitably they do when you operate with very little impulse control and where you don't recognize that your words as a president, whether they're in tweets or in statements that you make or in a press conference, resonate around the world and people take them seriously. And that can lead to foreign policy catastrophes or it can lead to domestic blow-ups. What kind of learning curve will we have? None of that do we know. Now, let me take it back one step, and we had some of this morning as well, and then I'll stop, on the healthcare front, and beyond all the other things that have to be done. But remember, we have a Senate where it is true that Democrats in the minority now cannot filibuster nominations. But if you know anything about the Senate, you know you can take any nomination and still make it use up a significant amount of time. So go past the cabinet members and think about the hundreds of others moving forward. You can take every one of them and deny unanimous consent to move forward and then demand 30 hours of debate. This is what McConnell did to slow up the schedule. And you have a Senate that doesn't really have an agenda to move forward on. So all of these deadlines are going to be very difficult to make. We have a debt ceiling issue coming up. Democrats now are not likely to provide votes, and you've got a core group of Freedom Caucus members who continue to say they're not going to vote to increase the debt ceiling as long as it involves more spending. They've got a crisis on that front. We have the budget reconciliation based on the budget resolution that passed the last time. They're turning more and more to making tax reform their top priority, which means, correct me if I'm wrong, Joe, they're going to have to do another budget resolution, which is going to be very difficult to make it through. And we do not have appropriations for the fiscal year that will last through the year. Most likely, they're going to try and do an omnibus, and they're going to package all kinds of things together. And if they put into that their wish list, that will include defunding public broadcasting, the National Endowment for the Arts and Humanities, and cutting all kinds of other domestic programs, with the Freedom Caucus saying, one, many of them, we don't want to go with the 20% increase in defense you're talking about, or at least remove the sequester caps on defense, but certainly we're going to have to double down on the cuts on domestic spending, and that can be filibustered in the Senate. We're likely headed for a shutdown, and we're going to have significant turmoil before we even begin to get to some of the substance here. I've turned to Twitter in the last year as my vent. I disdained it for a long time, and my publisher got me into it, and now it's my catharsis. But for the last year or so, every once in a while, I will do a tweet about Eric Cantor, who, as the Republican whip in the summer of 2009, when the Affordable Care Act was just in its gestation stages, said, and I quote, "Our alternative to Obamacare is weeks away." And Roy Blunt at the time said, "We guarantee you we'll have it very soon." So every once in a while I will tweet, 385 weeks and counting, 400 weeks and counting. At one of these angry town halls the other night, Marsha Blackburn of Tennessee, when asked about the alternative, said, "We've had it there for all that time. Here's a link to YouTube where you can watch the Blair House Summit in 2009, and that's our alternative." I wouldn't suggest that you waste your precious time watching the Blair House Summit, because I can just tell you there's no alternative there. It's some of the same talking points that went up before, and those talking points do not a policy make. And now we basically are nowhere with an alternative and nowhere with a plan. And of course, the great problem is, whatever CBO says, if you try and move forward with a repeal, even with a deadline of a couple of years away, which a lot of Republicans are not going to go for because they're being told by Jim DeMint and they've told everybody else, we're going to repeal, period. This is evil, it's awful, the whole policy is awful. How will insurance markets or hospitals react to that? Not well. Unless you provide them with some big bonus, either by restoring the risk corridors that you worked for years to blow up, or giving them some kind of a bribe, but where are you going to get the money for that? Because you don't have an appropriations process or a budget that will allow you to come up with the money. And if you simply keep as a placeholder the taxes, all of the ones we're talking about, you're going to get a lot of blowback from your own people. But how you use that in the short term, no easy answer. When you're in the minority, as Joe said, it is so much easier to just talk in black and white terms. When you're in a partisan tribal environment, instead of saying, you know, here are some reforms we want in this process, or now that you've rolled it out, as with every element of major policy, including Medicare Part D, you see the unintended consequences and you come back and you make adjustments. Technical corrections plus changes in the policy to make it work. We got none of that. There was no attempt to do anything other than to figure out how you could make it worse so that you could exploit that process and we'll worry about another plan down the road. Now, maybe in the end we'll get what many of us thought we would, which is we're going to repeal Obamacare and replace it with Obamacare. But I can't at this point find a path to get there either. So uncharted territory for all of us means, for me, very dark things potentially. Because if you read history, the slide step by step towards more authoritarianism, that always starts with calling the press the enemy of the people, is not something we're immune from. And to be frank, if I think, as I do often at night, in the middle of the night, where now I wake up as much with these thoughts as I do because of my prostate, which is a real problem, that the first person Donald Trump speaks to in the morning and the last one he speaks to at night is Steve Bannon, that is not a very pleasant thought. But even with that aside, we are moving into a time where making policy with enormous pressing problems in the country is going to be extraordinarily difficult to do. And trying to navigate through this while preserving even some semblance of a healthcare policy that needs major adjustments no matter what and is going to require not just more money as we move along, but a lot of changes in policy to make it work. That would be tough to do if you had a fully functional political process. Now, I'm not sure where we go. So that's probably a good place at which to stop and open it up. So, microphones, and please, as always, identify yourself.
Sorry, Cindy Enos. And I just wanted to ask what you thought about where the Russia investigations might go. Give us some insider perspective here.
Well, Cindy, where will the Russia investigation go? One of the other curiosities here, obviously, is that during the campaign and even after, you know, having a candidate, a president-elect, and a president going after the intelligence community, and at one point saying that the intelligence community is like the Nazi Germany and its leaks, is probably not a wise thing for a president to do. But it's leading us in a direction that is itself uncharted territory. We know some things now. One, we know, and we know definitively, that Russia made every effort to interfere with and change the outcome of the election, and that if they didn't think they could change the outcome, at the very least they wanted to do what they've done in many other countries in Eastern and Central Europe and what they're doing now in France and Germany, and that is to undermine contentment and acceptance of the existing regime and pit one group of people against another. And I think they were probably as surprised as most others were that they actually achieved the bonus of getting Donald Trump as president, but those efforts were real. And if I had to guess, and it's not just a guess from nowhere, they did hack into the Republican National Committee, and they do have a lot of evidence there, and there may well come a time when that will be released, and it will provide at least as much embarrassment as we saw with the Democratic National Committee. We know now that many people associated with Trump had regular communications with a lot of Russians, including high figures in the intelligence world. Even if they said they didn't know they were figures in the intelligence world, they were going back and forth to Russia a lot. We know that Michael Flynn got $40,000 to go to Moscow to sit with Vladimir Putin at the dinner honoring RT, the propaganda arm of the Russians, Jill Stein was at that table, and there were other figures who we'll learn a little bit more about. We know that Roger Stone, Paul Manafort, Carter Page, and others who are close to Trump had some of those communications and contacts, and that most of them were probably taped by American intelligence forces, and we're going to learn a lot more. The one thing that struck me was after a briefing of the Senate Intelligence Committee, if you just watch those members of both parties come out and look at their faces, you know this is not trivial stuff. We don't have a do-over in our Constitution. So we could end up with something that really leaves a lot of people unhappy and uneasy, and obviously can create international difficulties as well. But who knows where all of this goes? And the answer is that we don't. We do know that the president did not want to get rid of Michael Flynn, who was extremely close to him. I frankly find it hard to believe that Michael Flynn, after the election and before the election, was having regular phone calls with the Russian ambassador to the United States in which he talked about the sanctions, that he just did that on his own. Among other things, Michael Flynn is a military guy. You take orders. So there's more to unravel here, and it could lead to something very explosive. And you know, it's another one of these areas where we didn't expect that we would have this kind of an outcome. And in having that kind of an outcome, remember during the campaign, everybody was talking in the press, a major theme. He's pivoting now. Now he's going to become like a regular candidate. and then with the election. He's pivoting now. Now he's going to become like a normal president-elect. He's pivoting now. There's no pivot. This is Donald Trump. And in this area as well, we just don't know. Now, there's another part of this, too, which is remember that in 2008, his son said, we have so many investments in Russia, so much of our capital, so many of the loans are from Russia. And now you have a president saying, never, nothing with Russia. We know we have nothing. We have no money. We have nothing there. It's a private company. We don't have any tax returns or any way of knowing at this point. But at some point, we may know. And that's a problem as well. And I'd add one other thing. We have never had a president who started from the moment he was inaugurated in office violating the Constitution and the law. This one does. He has a lease with the federal government for his hotel in Washington. The lease itself explicitly says that if you are in government, you cannot be involved with this. Once he became president, that lease is invalid. He's now negotiating with himself effectively. And there are two emoluments clauses in the Constitution. The second one, in the Article 2, says a president's salary cannot be raised or lowered during that term, but the president can accept no emolument. And the definition over many centuries of emolument is anything of value from the federal government or the various states other than the salary. He's getting emoluments all over the place, including the lease terms here. And so, once again, we're in a different territory. The tribalism is, this is the sort of thing where you count on Congress to provide a check and balance. Nope.
So, my name is Aaron Reyes. I'm from the Community Health Initiative of Orange County. And in House of Representatives versus Burwell, the U.S. District Court found that the president can't offer subsidies because it wasn't the Congress had to do that. And so the thinking, I think, at the time was that the new administration would appeal. Do you have any sense of whether or not this administration would kind of appeal?
So it's now House of Representatives versus Price. They've changed the name of the lawsuit, and the House is saying that it wants a postponement for the obvious reasons. And what we may see is that the House tries to get out of this now by saying, okay, we'll appropriate the money. Now take us back to what I was saying 10 minutes ago or 5 minutes ago about where they're going to find the money to appropriate for this. So it's another part of the box that they're in. When they went out against the Affordable Care Act, they chose every avenue they could, including the legal ones, to undermine different elements of the act. And now some of that is coming back to bite them. And of course, they tried very carefully to choose the judges, and we're fairly confident on this one that they had a judge and a set of judges who would agree with them. But now if that happens, you get chaos again. All right, now we have all these town halls. And they're angry town halls, and they are very much parallel to what we saw with the Tea Party in 2009. And it may be that George Soros somehow is sending checks to millions of people all over the country every day to finance them going to these town halls, just as I've never seen, you know, if he was able on January 21st to somehow secretly send money to a million people around the world who demonstrated in the Women's March everything, this guy is a genius beyond anything we've ever seen. But they're organized, and they're all operating with the indivisible handbook and all of that. But these are not saboteurs, paid terrorists, or anything else. There are a lot of angry people there. And a lot of that anger is on the healthcare front. And I would just add one other thing. While it's true that you've got 90% of Republicans who support Trump, and the numbers that Dean put up about support for repealing Obamacare, and Mina's right as well. I mean, we have all these stories from the campaign. I'm glad that Trump is going to get rid of Obamacare, but he'll let me keep my Affordable Care Act, won't he? All of that aside, What we know is that working class white people who provide a substantial core of his base are going to be among the first ones hit by disruption in the healthcare market. And that could change the political dynamic very, very substantially along the way. And members of Congress know this, and I think they're really, that's why you saw the tape of the session that they had at their retreat in Pennsylvania. The angst is so palpable. Sure.
Thanks very much. Cheryl Skolnick from Mizuho Securities. Norm, I didn't hear too much about the Democrats in your chat with us today. Certainly, they bear some weight and responsibility for the outcome we are now facing. So, two questions. One, your assessment of what went wrong on the Democratic side, because it wasn't just things being done to them.
Okay? Yep.
And two, what those of us who might be more concerned about the future of our country being a little bit more like a republic than Nazi Germany, what we should be doing now.
So on the former front, obviously the Democratic Party had its own dilemma going into this campaign. And for Hillary Clinton, it was the same dilemma that she faced in 2008, which is you're running at a time when people want a candidate of change, and you just can't be a candidate of change. She got hit by Obama in 2008, and by Bernie Sanders, but other forces in 2016, and that was a problem. Figuring out a way to run against Donald Trump became a problem as well. You know, a campaign that I think did not, and a party that has not adequately realized the roots of this populism, and that includes addressing in any significant way the inequality, the stagnant wages, the problems that will emerge down the road. You know, this morning, just to take it back for a second, Trump met with a bunch of manufacturing CEOs. And they went around the table and they were all, you know, bowing down to him and all of that. And he was talking and he said, you know, you're bringing back these jobs and you're bringing back those jobs. And he thanked the head of United Technologies, which is the parent company for Carrier. And of course, what Carrier did was announce they were going to send 2,000 jobs to Mexico. Then they got a $7 million tax break from Indiana, sent 1,200 jobs, kept 800 jobs, which will be disappearing before you know it, and accepted the kudos. But of course, the reality is the problem is not the jobs going to Mexico, it's the jobs going to robots. And that's with artificial intelligence moving at an incredibly rapid pace. You know, maybe there will come a time when, if any of you saw Battlestar Galactica, there'll all be Cylons out to destroy humanity. But along the way, jobs are going away. And they're not just manufacturing jobs. And the Democratic Party, I do not think, has thought through or recognized ways of addressing the anxieties that people feel about their future and their children's futures. At the same time, the fact is that while the parties polarized, it was asymmetric. The Republican Party went off the rails. The Democratic Party moved, but it stayed center left. Now there is an enormous pull, which is almost inevitable. A reaction breeds a counter-reaction, pulling the Democrats towards the left. And I think it's a dangerous pull, dangerous in a whole set of ways. If you have two parties that completely abandon the center, then your ability to work within the framework of a republic dissipates, and you have an awful lot of people who are the glue in the society and the political system who are left without a home, and there's no easy outlet for that. At the same time, you're going to embrace a set of policies, and there will be some convergence on the left and right, and that includes the protectionism that we see out there, that are not very healthy policies. And if you watch any of the dynamic now surrounding the Democratic National Committee chairmanship race, see what's happening in some of the states, the traction is with the more extreme left. And I don't think that's a very healthy sign. And at the same time, if you're just looking at this from a pragmatic perspective as a Democrat worried about 2018, if you get an all-out war against Heidi Heitkamp and Joe Manchin and John Tester and Brian Donnelly, who represent deeply red states and who are going to vote in a lot of ways that reflect their assessment of the states, and they are attacked from the left, you're probably going to lose those seats. And then you may see a Senate that moves closer to having 60 Republicans. So it's, I think, a real challenge. And of course, the challenge that many of the panelists earlier talked about, what do you do to cooperate, or how much do you buy the McConnell playbook of contesting everything, filibustering everything, make it all look bad, with in some ways the attitude being, yeah, it's gonna hurt a lot of people, but that's worth it because we can take back power. At some point, you gotta say, we've gotta stop hurting people. But right now is probably not that point. And we're gonna find some real challenges ahead on that front, and seeing where you can find leverage and seeing whether there's a point at which Democrats and Republicans in the Senate, 8-10 Republicans in the Senate, can join forces. The best outcome we could have right now would be if you could get 60 senators to say, we're not going to accept this. Here's what will work, and here's what won't. And they've got the leverage to be able to do that if you can find enough people willing to do it. But that doesn't solve the Democrats' problem. And frankly, there is no obvious leader or set of leaders looking towards 2020. And you could well have 17 candidates, and you could well imagine one emerging being somebody significantly to the left of Bernie Sanders.
Yes. Hi, this is Rahul Gupta from St. Joseph Health. You spoke a lot about different cycles of angry populism. Is this cycle any different than the previous ones, and why, if that's the case?
So let me just, I want to quote a little bit from a new book called The Age of Anger by Pankaj Mishra, which takes this deep and long historical view. What the world has endured in the quarter century since the end of the Cold War, the triumph of political liberty and economic globalization, only to be followed by financial crises, populist movements, and transnational terrorism, is but the latest iteration on a wider scale of what has happened for centuries. The unprecedented political, economic, and social disorder that accompanied the rise of the industrialist capitalist economy in 19th century Europe and led to world wars, totalitarian regimes, and genocide in the first half of the 20th century is now infecting much vaster regions and bigger populations. And that is not necessarily what's going to happen to us, but it is a global phenomenon right now. And it is clear there's an awful lot of unease and a sense of dislocation. And in some places, as in Europe, it is being amplified dramatically by what is a genuine immigration crisis rather than what we have here. And I must say, watching General Kelly, who does not appear to be a bright and shining light at the moment, say, reinforcing what President Trump had said, we continue to have this massive wave of illegal immigration over the southern border, which is just false. It's not true at all. But they are having real pressures on immigration in other places. But what they're also seeing is the same kind of dislocation, and that promise that the new information age was going to make people's lives better. And they see some people whose lives are just fantastic. They're driving incredible cars, they've got private jets, they're living very well, and you're not, leads you to lean towards a Geert Wilders in the Netherlands, or a Marine Le Pen, or to give this leverage to a Nigel Farage. And remember, the first person that Trump had from the world outside the United States come over after his election was Nigel Farage. One of the first five people he met with in Trump Tower was Marine Le Pen. That you're seeing this take place in Turkey. We're seeing it in many other places where totalitarians or authoritarians have greater appeal to people than democratic regimes, with all the messiness and with the requirement that you trust a much wider range of elites that people don't like. So ours has its own unique characteristics, and to some degree they're milder than what you see elsewhere. But you could look at history and not feel very comfortable with the direction that things are taking. And if this takes over more broadly around the world, the threat to the fundamental world order is real and substantial. We cannot and should not sugarcoat any of this. And to get back to Cheryl's question, what do we do now? There is no easy answer to that, obviously. But one thing is, there has to be more than just marching, and after you're marching, saying, I've done my part. Marching has to turn to organizing. It has to turn to activating voters. It has to turn to protecting voters from suppression. It has to move to at least providing some guidance and leeway for elected officials to figure their way out of this, but setting some boundaries around where we are. And it has to include a courage and a willingness to step up if we see a slide towards more authoritarianism. And that means supporting free news media. It means speaking up when really bad things are done and said. It means trying to build dialogue with people who now are very comfortable and cosseted in their own closed information loops, which is one of the greatest dangers that we have. And it means being careful what you say to those and not just denigrating everybody who's on the other side, trying to figure out where they're coming from and move them a little bit away from bad impulses and temptations. There's not an easy way to do it. And it also involves moving towards a set of reforms or laws or changes, most of them at the state and local level now, that can make things a little bit better. I'm very impressed, for example, with the efforts of Jason Kander, who was the Senate candidate for the Democrats in Missouri, before that the Secretary of State, who started an organization to try and protect and enhance the vote around the country. That's a really important thing right now. So, for all of you who work in the health sphere, this is a challenging time. I will tell you, just as somebody who's gotten very much engaged for a very, very unfortunate set of reasons in mental health policy, I'm scared to death about what's going to happen with Medicaid. Because if we're going to get people treated, where we need an expansion so we get more beds, number one, where you can get people off the streets because Medicaid can provide them with some additional support and find them a place to live, and you cap it, do a per capita that is going to mean that any states that wanted to expand Medicaid are screwed forever, do a block grant, that's the last place money's going to go. It's a real challenge. And we're going to have to find also areas in the private sector to try and ameliorate some of the human cost here. And one of the other things is every lawyer in America who cares about this has got to step up now and help immigrants learn immigration law and also learn more about health care, health policy, health law to help people as well. This is a very testing time for the country. One last question, Sarit.
A question. We are recovering economically. Will we be capable to survive the Trump presidency? Will we just come out of it just badly bruised? Do we have the capacity, since we're the strongest economy in the world, to actually survive through this, be it 4 years or 8 years? What is kind of your thought on this?
I will say, one of the things that president said this morning, which was, again, to attack other countries' currencies, is one of those areas that troubles me a great deal. Trade wars, currency wars, are not out of the question. Bad policies that could lead to trade wars, not out of the question. At the same time, if we get, and it's still problematic, but if we get these giant tax cuts and we get a massive infrastructure plan and we get a 20% increase in defense, we're going to have the most hyper-stimulative fiscal policy in the history of the world coming at a bad time. You do that when you're down on the canvas. You don't do it when you're near full employment and when the economy is starting to move and you're actually seeing some increase in real wages. And that could lead us to a sugar high for a couple of years. And then we know what happens after a sugar high is you get very bad things happening. Now, the other thing that worries me on that front is we are likely to see the Fed under those conditions, if that happens, making adjustments to protect against inflation. Janet Yellen will be the chairman of the Fed for another year. For any of you who saw the last commercial of the Trump campaign, which singled out Janet Yellen and Lloyd Blankfein and George Soros, they all have one thing in common. They were called part of the international banking conspiracy. Some of us are old enough to remember what that meant. And I can see Trump going after Janet Yellen in a big way, and I can see Steve Bannon going after her in a bad way. And none of that would be good either for the economy or for the country. So here again, we're in uncharted territory. We do know that Steve Mnuchin, the Treasury Secretary, when asked about the tax cuts today, said, well, we're going to use economic assumptions that are very different from what the others are using. So, you know, you can get a $10 trillion tax cut and magically make it into a surplus if you want. And for Joe, who is a veteran of the Congressional Budget Office, which has this quite remarkable history going back to Alice Rivlin of being independent, there's a real challenge now. If you start by saying, I want you to assume 3.5% growth for the country into the indefinite future and jam everything else into that, and if you don't, you're out of luck and out of work. That's a big problem. And the other position that I'm keeping an eye on is the parliamentarian of the Senate, because we're going to get another reconciliation package coming forward, and a parliamentarian who is scrupulous in deciding what's allowable under reconciliation and what isn't may find also a need for another job. So there's a lot of pressures here and a lot happening. And I can tell you, leaving with the good news, that my business is doing really well. Thank you.